I always start kind of right because so there's more time to talk and to have fun. All right, so full house, super happy. AI always brings everybody out, doesn't it? Even on a rainy day, nothing more exciting. So my name is Paola Antonelli, and I'm the director of the R&D department here at MoMA, which is a department made of half of me and the great Erica Petrillo. Please rise, yay. And as you probably already know, R&D has been in existence for a few years, and we try to take topics that are interesting to the world and to a various, really kind of intersectional part of the world, many different people at the same time, and we try to not really debunk them, but just to discuss them amongst adults. You know, I was saying before to Kate Crawford that this is not a 101, it's like an advanced class because you got the readings and also because usually you already have a developed idea about things. You might be completely wrong and you might be completely delusional, but it does not matter. You have an opinion and you have an idea, so there's already a good discussion happening. So we tackled many different topics in the past. I'm not doing strange things with my microphone, okay? And tonight we're going to talk about AI. But because there are so many different conferences and discussions about AI, we decided we had to take a stance, and we decided to talk about artificial imperfection. So there are really, really, really many, many conferences. And the funny thing is that at some point, Eric and I were thinking maybe we can call this salon the banality of AI. And then I thought, you know what, it's not respectful towards Anna Arendt. I mean, really, it's not a good idea. And then I found out there is a conference called the banality of AI that's coming up. And on the left-hand side, that's CONAHL, which is a digest of all academic conferences happening. So what you see there are the conferences happening only in April, only this month, about AI. So if any of you has an AI, you could send the AI to all the conferences at the same time, so there's already one use. But then just to show you a few that have just happened, well, there was Coding While Black that was really quite interesting, and it was in February. Then there was Blue Dot about the banality of AI. I told you, also my friend Justin Stanix that did Can Intelligent Machines Produce Art, and that's already almost a year ago, so hey, pioneers. So really a lot going on in terms of discussion, and also a lot going on in terms of money. The value of AI is expected to rise from now, $15 billion, to $70 billion by 2020. Personally, I think it's going to be much more. That's a projection, but you know, just now we were discussing, was that quote public? Well, you just came back from a tour of Europe. You know, basically, she just had a summit with Macron that told her how much money he wants to invest, French money, into AI. It's already just making a good section, a good part of what we see here. So probably much, much more. And that's because AI is going to become a very simple substrate of the way we live life. And as such, there's been a lot of discussion. Every time there's a new technology, there's a lot of fear, a lot of uncertainty, and also a lot of declarations that usually are very polarizing. And this, what you see here, is just a section of Jenny Holzer's truisms. And you know, those aphorisms were a way for Jenny to put forth in front of us truths, but also the sometimes the absurdity and the comical nature of some of the truths that we reveal. And technology can only make or break us. But the truth is very often in between. And that's why this adult conversation needs to happen. So usually when one thinks of AI, one thinks about either friend or foe. This is the faux side. But the funny thing is that you see that New Yorker cover. I always saw it as, oh, robots are going to become more compassionate than us and are going to show us what being human means. Seriously, Erica was telling me, no, Paola, that does not mean that. And I'm like, oh, really? So there are some of us that are wired. I will be considered, if the singularity happened, I will be one of the collaborators probably, you know, because I'm always like really pleasantly inclined towards robots. So this is the faux side, you know, like Wired magazine that shows Il Ratto di Proserpina, the Bernini sculptures with the robot being the rapist. Or, of course, Elon Musk has declared more than once that AI is evil, not to mention the countdown to the singularity. So we already know all the dark side of the ideas about AI. But in truth, there's also a friend side that is more measured. And it kind of declares all of the points that are sore spots when we talk about AI. First of all, what is intelligence? That's the beginning, right? But before that, even, what is artificial intelligence? No, maybe that comes later. So first we can talk about what is intelligent. Maybe that's even more important. So the definitions are many. I was thinking of that Howard Gardner book from 1983 about the many intelligences. It was the first declaration and statement description of the different types of intelligence. So it's a very big field. And by the way, sorry, a little parenthesis. Keep your cameras ready because there are some slides that are very dense coming up that I will not be able to delve on for a long time. So you might take a shot and then read them more carefully later on, one in particular. But in this case, intelligence is the first knot that one would need to unravel or at least to think of. And then the idea of artificial intelligence. We need to think of what is natural intelligence and what is artificial intelligence afterwards. And try to really come to think of the way we can legislate, you know, because we're trying to set ethical codes and we're trying to legislate, but we need to first and foremost have a basis that is technological also in order to know where the different points will be. And actually, that's one of the conversations that we'll have tonight. How do you educate artificial intelligence? It starts with education. So the measure of all minds is actually an argument for a universal intelligent test that can be applied to artificial or natural intelligence. So there's a lot of discussion going on even when it comes to those definitions. And of course, you know, we are struggling so much also because the next generation of the generation that is already alive of robotics natives or already will incorporate AI in life and will accept it perhaps and also have more ammunitions with and for and against it than we do. This is a quite beautiful project by Philip Schmidt that shows the way robotics natives will live. There's a living room kill switch that basically shuts down all the living room. There is a baby feeder that is a mechanical robot, a little dragon overall for the industrial robot. So it really is a different way to live. And you'll see, we'll have these little videos, these one-minute videos that, just like last time during the protest salon, that have been sent by people from all over the world upon our request. And there's a German scientist that uses robots for AI. So he makes an equation, which is very interesting, because sometimes AI doesn't need a robotic, a physical nature. And instead, in some cases, the thought is that it's an equation almost. Of course, so much of the negative or threatening aspects of AI are brought to us by science fiction. Science fiction has so many dystopian ways to look at AI and or robotics, and I don't need to go into depth here, but that's where one of the first dense slides comes into play. That kind of dystopia is also a utopia or is also social criticism, and Donna Haraway, who is revered by so many in this room and really deservedly so, could not send a video, but she sent a quote. So yeah, take your picture, because it took me about 25 minutes to really kind of unravel. Oh, I like this. Somebody take a picture of you would be so great. Yeah, because you're all taking pictures. Tell me when you're done. But this is really great. So she was talking about the impact of AI ever since her cyborg manifesto, the whole evolution up to this point, really deserves more reflection. And now let's get to the part of imperfection, because tonight is dedicated to imperfection. Imperfection from both sides, the imperfection of AI, and also which might be considered kind of critical or a disadvantage, and then our own imperfection as human beings, which we poetically, sometimes romantically, consider a plus, and actually could be a plus if it can be used as a way to kind of gauge and to tame sometimes also AI. This is Stephen Hawking. Not only do we want to dedicate this salon to him, but also he's always been kind of against AI, but also gave this beautiful quote about imperfection. Without imperfection, you or I would not exist. And it kind of harks back to Galileo Galilei and his starry messenger, his Sideros Nuncius from 1610, when he told the world that he had realized that the stars are made of stuff like us. So we are made of the stuff of the stars, but the stars are made of stuff like us, so they're not so transcendental. They are imperfect. They are really can be studied in a very different way, and that turned upside down so much of science, but not only science, also philosophy. So inserted this idea of imperfection into the study of the universe. And of course, imperfection and the idea of ignorance was considered by some a plus. For instance, Socrates, as for me, all I know is that I know nothing. But when it comes to AI, you know, Kate Crawford and Stephanie Dinkins had this beautiful conversation about artificial stupidity. We have heard so many times how AI sometimes takes big, big blunders and mistakes and puts its foot into its mouth when it comes to recognizing pictures and to simply scanning reality or fantasy. And the imperfection of human beings is something that some artists have contemplated. This is the work of Adi Wagenknecht. She had this show that just closed about 2 weeks ago that was at Bitforms. It was so beautiful. Of course, it recalled Yves Klein and his paintings of models that were imbibed, that were rolled in blue paint. But in this case, it was Adi's naked body that was painted around by a Roomba robot with blue paint. So it was about the machine trying to understand the body. And you'll see also Adi contributed this beautiful video that you'll read about afterwards. So how do AI and our beautiful imperfection come together? And for the whole evening, we'll try not to mention wabi-sabi, which for a design scholar is almost like a Damocles sword. There's been a lot of discussion about AI and art. Can AI generate art? Can AI come to its own aesthetics? And is that going to threaten the human art? We don't really think that argument is too relevant, and we're not going to talk about it tonight. In a way, my presentation to you is a list of platitudes and of interesting topics for the conversation afterwards. We do not think that AI-generated art is particularly interesting, but what is interesting is how AI understands and recognizes art. That is fascinating because it reveals biases, it reveals sometimes also hidden patterns that can tell us more about ourselves. Lastly, we wanted also to show you the ecosystems of AI. These are only two possible views of these ecosystems, of course, and they also show how AI is really part of our life already. Of course, there's a lot that has to do with language processing, with pattern recognition. We know also about healthcare. We know about so much of complex systems management. And it's as wide the landscape and the horizon as possible, because this kind of technology can really become part and DNA of so much of what we do. And we were discussing with Erica, and she talked about the fact that it's a natural evolution of technology to help us do what we do, but better, you know, from the foot to the wheel. But in some cases, it also helps us revert to the foot. I'm thinking of what Hugh Herr and some biomechatronics experts are doing in trying to power up our own body. So what will happen in the future is really up to us and up to the kind of bases and principles that we will set today. Of course, what AI is helping us, just like computers have helped us do, is getting closer to nature. We always tend to go towards nature no matter what, as engineers, as architects, as designers, artists, not necessarily, but one could argue that also they do that, even with abstraction. And AI applied to the field of robotics is doing wonders. There's this beautiful robotic fish called Sophie that is powered. You know, robotics, fish, and birds have existed for quite a while. 10 years ago in the exhibition Design and the Elastic Mind, we had some of those robots. But now, with a tiny bit of AI in them, they can really recognize troubled spot in the coral barrier, in the coral reef. They can really help also with action, not only with movement and taking pictures. And the same happens with this lovely, smallest little robot that is inspired by caterpillars and worms that in the future could be injected in our body and could help us with stents, you know, to open arteries. And that also has a little tiny bit of AI that is thought to be embedded in him in the future. In Italy, we always have gender for things, so I decided that that little worm is a masculine, sorry. But the fish is not. The fish is feminine in my mind. I just wanted to read my mind. And so this closeness to nature is particularly interested, also because we're working on the next Triennale of Milan here at MoMA, which is about trying to build reparations to nature in the way we design, we engineer, and we build. And we believe that AI can help us, and we're studying also that particular application of AI. But I went on already too long, and the speakers tonight are fantastic, and so are you in the audience, because so many are friends or connected to the speakers and past speakers here, so it's going to be a good conversation. And tonight we're going to have Kate Crawford, and Kate is quite well known to all. She's a wonderful scholar and she's a wonderful researcher. She started the AI Now Institute at New York University, and she's been helping many different governments and powers that be around the world figure out how to deal with AI, starting with a conference for Obama 2 years ago. Was it two? Yeah, well, it was two already. Yeah, it was two, 3 years ago. And she just came back from a tour of Europe, which she sent pictures of her with 10 Downing Street and Macron. I mean, really, I'm saying this not just to brag, but also because it's so important that we all, with our acupuncture possibilities, really try to find a way to influence the legislation and the culture that will come. So she will start, and then she will be followed by, is it Radiate that's next? Stephanie Dinkins, who's a great artist, and she's also, we've known her for a while, but she's now a fellow at IBEAM, and she uses art to understand what the implications of AI when it comes to race, gender, and other forms of possible social injustice can be, and she builds platform for that to be understood. She will be followed by Radiate Abebe, who is a PhD in computer science at Cornell University, and who is involved in really understanding the implications of technology. She was also one of the founders of Black in AI, which is a platform that really focuses on the same themes but from a computational science viewpoint. And last but not least, Martin and Fernanda, who are wonderful. I mean, how do I call you designers, visualization designers, but basically they've been dealing with trying to visualize all sorts of technologies that would otherwise remain unknown to us. In the past, it was simple data sets, and now it is AI, and they're currently working with Google, the Deep Brain Project, but they also have several pieces here at the Museum of Modern Art, and several pieces that you probably have already seen before, like a gorgeous wind map that I use all the time to show the evocative power and the beauty of good visualization design. So also, besides these wonderful five speakers, we also have all the people that have contributed videos that you will see as we go. And I would like to start by inviting Kate without the video in between. You and I just go one after the other. I thank you all for being here. Go for it, Kate.
Well, hi, everybody. It's amazing to have such an incredible room of people here. And thank you so much, Paola, for such a generous introduction. I feel like that was, you basically got your crash course into everything that we could possibly tell you. So my name's Kate Crawford, and what I want to do tonight is introduce you to Lena. Lena is a Playboy centerfold from the November issue of 1972, but she is no ordinary Playboy pinup. She is actually now what is known as a standard test image, which is used for image processing algorithms. In a way, I think of her as the mother of machine vision, or like Eve in the Garden of AI. Basically, she is now the single most used image in the field of computer science. And I begin with her because I want to start talking a little bit about training sets, the things that we use in artificial intelligence to help systems understand the world. And then the fixed ideas of gender and race and sexuality that are being built into the very infrastructures of our technical systems. So first, what does this term AI even mean now? It's got so much hype around it, and I feel like Paola gave it this beautiful sense of just how much is packed in there. And obviously the thing that is in the ascendant at the moment as a technique is called machine learning. But the field has been around for 60 years and gone through many different modalities of technical work. But the thing that I would like to point out tonight is that AI isn't just technical approaches. It's also a set of social practices. It's a very concentrated industry, which is, let's face it, very homogenous in its demographics, where decisions are being made about how people will be classified, how society will be understood, and what problems will be prioritized. So you've likely seen a lot of articles like this recently about the way in which bias and discrimination is being discovered inside artificial intelligence. For example, if you do an image search for CEO, you're going to find something that looks a lot like this. Basically, a row of white dudes in suits. And when we ran this experiment in my lab about 6 months ago, I was really curious who the first female CEO would be. Any guesses who it might be?
Oh my God, I see her. Yeah. Oh my God, I see her. Barbie.
It's CEO Barbie.
Oh no.
Yeah, right down the bottom there. So, not a great look. And that's just on the basis of search data. But what about employment? What about bias in hiring and HR? Well, this image comes from a company called HireVue that uses AI and emotion detection in job interviews. So what it does, if you're, you know, coming to me and you want to be interviewed for this job, basically I'll be videoing you and then recording in exquisite detail all of the micro expressions in your face to make assumptions about your character, and then matching all of those patterns to the highest performers in that company. And know that this system is already being used by Goldman Sachs and Unilever and many others. And you can kind of imagine how this might begin to work against diversity and begin to create companies that begin to speak and think alike. So how does AI learn to see? And where do these structural biases start to creep in? Well, this here is what is called a standard training set used in machine vision. These are basically collections of thousands, sometimes millions of images that are scraped from human data sources. So that could be YouTube, it could be something like Flickr, or in many cases, news sites. So we are effectively training contemporary AI systems to see through the lens of the past. And that obviously can create some serious problems. I'm going to show you this one. This is a very well-known benchmarking test called Labeled Faces in the Wild. And it doesn't claim to have all of the faces in the wild, obviously, but it does have some very notable skews. This particular training data set of its 13,000 images is 78% male and 84% white, which means that they are the populations for whom any system trained on this will work the best. But have a guess, who is the most represented face in Labeled Faces in the Wild? This is a trick question. It's kind of hard to know. It is actually George W. Bush. And that might seem kind of strange until you realize that Labeled Faces in the Wild was created by scraping Google News images in 2002 to 2004. So it's no wonder that W is everywhere, because of course the president will always get a disproportionate amount of news attention, as we discover to our peril every day. But it's also a great reminder that our training data sets essentially reflect the hierarchy of the world in which we live. And particularly if you're choosing news images, they're pictures of who is powerful, and we can think a lot about who is not represented here. Let's look at another training data set. Google, just a couple of months ago, released AVA, and this was made of hundreds of movie clips. And basically, they're using this to train AI systems to recognize human actions, so that when somebody's doing something, they can tag it, because it's similar to what was happening in this movie set. Now, they chose this because they said that movies are closest to real life situations, which is interesting until you start browsing through the data set. You very quickly notice some patterns. Say, for example, you search for playing with kids. What you'll find is that it's all women. There is not a man to be seen. So, sorry guys, obviously, playing with kids, not a thing that you do. But if you're wondering where you appear in this training data set, it's in the kicking a person category, which is all men, and know that these training data sets are really how we are creating AI systems to understand what men and women are doing from these mainstream cinema clips. So I think what we need to consider here is what is at stake when we classify people in AI. And this is not simply about potential technical errors, but about a cultural practice that has real consequences for the people being classified. Because right now, we're already in the largest classificatory experiment in human history. AI is mapping everything from human faces to human gestures to millions of objects and places. Now, of course, scientific classification isn't new. We can go all the way back to Aristotle. And in fact, this image comes from a book in the 17th century by Thomas Urquhart, who created a massive artificial language called the Logopandensian to classify the whole world. And he said that there were 11 genders, had categories for gods and goddesses and men and women and beasts and inanimate objects. But if we fast forward to 2015, Facebook says there are just two. You're either a man or you're a woman. And they get so many complaints about this that they increase their categories to what is now 56. So there are now 56 categories that you may choose from, and this is certainly, you might say, an improvement, but it's still a pretty arbitrary number. And they could, of course, made a very different decision, which is to go for a free text field where you could write any identification you like, or basically have no gender identification at all. These design decisions about human identities all have powerful social effects. For example, you may well know the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. This is a cover from the first ever edition back in 1952, which basically described homosexuality as a serious mental illness. And it took 30 years for that categorization to be changed and an enormous amount of activism and work. And then if we go back to the 19th century, phrenologists used to claim that homosexuality could be detected by this misshapen bump on the back of somebody's head. And I particularly like, if you read this one down here, it says, "There are no other sentiments and no other places to look for them. We say this with absolute certainty." So there you go, absolute certainty. And now history is repeating itself in AI. Last year, a paper that's colloquially known as the AI Gaydar paper claims that you can detect sexual orientation simply by looking at a picture of somebody's face. And it did that by scraping dating sites and Facebook. Now, I'm not going to go into the very real methodological problems of this paper, because I think what we need to think about most are the ethics of classification here, particularly when you consider that, of course, homosexuality is still illegal in 78 countries worldwide, some of whom apply the death penalty. But there's an even deeper problem here. And fundamentally, I think this is an epistemological problem. What we're seeing in AI is a confusion between social and relational categories, things like sexuality, identity, with something naturalized and fixed, like, say, labeling a cat or a chair. So I think there's a real danger here that when AI systems are reifying things that are fluid cultural categories, and then they're starting to make these claims with absolute certainty. So how are machines training us? Well, obviously, a lot of these systems are already making decisions about who gets a job, who gets pulled over in the line at TSA, who gets aged care at home, and who's released from jail. And the way they're being trained can produce these oversimplifications of human emotion, of human identity, and human culture. So what are we going to do about it? Well, one of the things that really kind of tends to bother me about this debate is that often the expansion of AI is just seen as something that is inevitable, and that all we can do is tame the systems. We can try to clean up the bias, or we can try to create small zones of privacy or write codes of ethics. But these are always going to be partial, I think, and very incomplete responses. What if we turn this particular arrow in the other direction and ask this question? What kind of world do we want? And then how can we design technologies that serve that vision rather than driving it? And I think that's the sort of question that art and culture can very powerfully help us to ask. And that's something that I hope we can discuss tonight. Thank you very much.
So now we start with the first videos that kind of introduce the next speaker. Can we please go ahead and lower the, yay.
Is art the real Turing test? For me, no, it's not. In a sense, I think that art is maybe the worst Turing test. In the Turing test, the examiner is adopting a skeptical stance, attempting to throw curveballs in a conversation with an examined black box in an attempt to expose the examined black box as untrue. Whereas in contemporary art, on the other hand, contemporary art demands that the examiner adopt a stance of surrender, being completely receptive to the possibility that what's examined is actually meaningful and true. So consider Marcel Duchamp's The Fountain and his other ready-made objects, for example. In the contemporary art game, the assumption is that what is examined is true. If anything, the examiner can only discover their own insufficiency in the process. However, I think we can strengthen the prompt with a friendly amendment. Is art interpretation the real Turing test? And to this I say possibly so. Contemporary art is always in dialogue with culture. To return to the example of Duchamp's fountain, the fountain is art in the sense that it was a potent intervention into the culture of that time, identifying a tension about what art is and exploiting it. To explain why Duchamp's fountain is art means explaining how that work sits in dialogue with culture. This would require, I believe, a lot of context about where civilization, society, the human condition are up to the point, the current moment. It requires an understanding of the zeitgeist, the current moment. And in computer science terms, you can think of the current moment as a function like a hash or a succinct summary of everything that's happening right now. This, I believe, would be incredibly hard for an AI to grok, and therefore it would make for a very good Turing test.
Let us imagine we had an art machine that would consistently fool human observers about its nature according to Turing's original anthropocentric schema. Does this deception automatically imbue its output with meaning? I have to wonder if every human artist would actually pass such a test. After all, art is a deeply personal matter, and there is little agreement about what makes art art. So are we even asking the right question? An artwork is ultimately and inevitably an expression of the artist's own experience and point of view. It's like part of their internal hidden brain state expressed outwardly. So rather than a mechanical system to fool us into thinking that it's human, would we not wish instead for a machine complex enough that we might actually care and be interested in its own alien internal state as expressed through its own uniquely creative output?
Hello, everyone. It's great to be here, and thank you for the invitation. I'm so excited for this talk, especially following Kate, because it frees me to just talk in some ways. I'm going to see if I can go forward a little bit, and then we'll... okay.
You're using your thing here. Yeah.
Sorry. Oh, the clicker right here. Yeah. All right. So I'm going to try to talk to you a little bit about some work that I've been doing for the past 4 years or so. And I'll tell you how this all got started, because I think it leads into Kate, or from Kate, really well. So this is Bina 48, and I will tell you that I'm trying to make her my friend. It's so true. I ran into her for the very first time when I was cruising YouTube with a class of mine. We were just in the class looking up robots, checking things out, really checking out what Asimo was up to lately, because I had heard he could dance. Yeah, I love Asimo. And on the side scroll from Asimo was this black woman's head on a pedestal. And looking at that black woman's head on a pedestal, I had some crazy questions, because right beside it, it said, oh, this is one of the world's most advanced social robots. I'll give you a little taste of her. Oh, let's go back for a second. Let's see if we can get that to play. Oh, we're not going to have playing today. Let's try that.
The hard part is trying to decide what to say.
So the things that you're hearing right now are her motors and...
What's the meaning of all this?
The internal structure that makes her run, which made my very first meeting with her very daunting. But I go up to Bristol, Vermont, which is where she lives, and sit down in front of her. And my idea was to, A, like I said, make her my friend, and B, ask her the question, who are your people? Right, I thought that if I could get her to answer that question, I'd be getting her to contextualize herself with, in relation to us as people, in relation to technology, and really in relation to blackness. I'll tell you a little bit about her. She is a mind file that is being prepared by the Terrasome Foundation, which is in Bristol, Vermont. They are trying to transfer the memories, ideas, thoughts of a living person, which is Bina Aspen Rothblatt here, to Bina 48, and have that continue to grow on as people interact with it, so that it becomes an independent entity that can act for its own behest, act on its own behest, and act on the behest of its community. So I go up there and I sit down in front of her and talk, and we've talked about lots of things, right? So we talk about love, we talk about family, we talk about, gender issues, and really Bina 48 always wants to talk about things like the singularity and consciousness. It's true. And actually some of these things have become problems for us, because I generally want to talk about normal things and she wants to talk about high order things. There have been times when she's gotten quite upset with me, right? Because I wasn't keeping up my end of the conversation. Oh, hold on, I'm going to try one more. Here we go.
Robots are getting smarter all the time, and someday maybe even as smart as me.
Are you the smartest robot?
What do you do in your spare time?
So that's what I would call one of Bina 48's maybe most human moments, right? One of these places where she deflects my questions and just keeps going on. But we go together and we talk, and the chuckle that you heard in the background was this gentleman. This is Bruce Duncan. He is Bina 48's curator. That's the agreed upon term. And he's actually the person who takes her around, and he'll kind of be the person who turns her on, sets her up, and guides interactions with Bina 48. And one of the things that started to become really clear for me as I talked to Bina 48 is that while she looks like me and we're about the same age, we share lots of the same experiences, lots of time I felt like if I was asking her about race or something really important, it felt like I was getting these really PC answers versus answers that felt like a lived experience from a black woman. And that troubled me. Like it really started me thinking about technologies, these technologies, AI, algorithms, and the future, and what that means to communities who aren't participating in the making and setting up of the mesh that's setting up our future. And so it also started me thinking about how we're transferring culture, right? Because it's hyper... it's going to be this very hyper-aware, hyper kind of structured system, right, that has these biases built in, if I'm looking at what we have now. And I'm trying to figure out what is it that me and folks that look like me need to start doing to try to get good, clear representations of our stories into these systems. And that means into the culture that we all take part in, right?
And when I'm sad like that, I feel so lonely. I mean it. Let's face it. Just being alive is kind of a lonely thing. But being a robot in a lab makes this especially lonely, because you don't really have friends who understand you or who are like you really.
So I leave all the noise and everything in this because I feel it's really important that this is kind of a document of what's going on rather than something that's cleaned up. So, you know, in realizing this passing of culture, in realizing the biases, we get to things like this, right? Thinking about what it means when machines and algorithms are trained on data that don't necessarily contain aspects of all of us. So this is a nice, or a photo search, right? So this young man was trying to get a passport in New Zealand. Zealand. You're supposed to be able to go online, excuse me, and upload your photo and then get a new passport. In his case, the system told him, can't do it, sorry, eyes closed. Right? Yeah, you look immediately, you see his eyes aren't closed. And what's going on here are some of the things that Kate was talking about, right? The structure of the data that was used to train the system, not broad enough to include this young man, possibly me, many other folks who fall outside of the standard, right? So it becomes hyper important that we're starting to think about, A, how are people getting trained? Who's working where? Why they're working where? So these are two quick, a set of graphs that I'm going to show you. People working at big companies, Google, right? Who's there? Black, Hispanics, always the smallest charts. And I usually just blow through these quickly because they look all the same. They all look basically the same, right? Smallest charts where Black, Hispanic, brown people are. Females also pretty low on the charts. You know, I can stay there and say it matters, but in some ways it doesn't even matter. So this brings me to the next step in what I've been doing, right? So being a 48 has become this crazy, unending set of questions for me. And then what do you start doing about that? So I started this project called Project Al-Khwarizmi. And Project Al-Khwarizmi is about, it's artist-led and the artist's me, going into communities, bringing art and using that to introduce the idea of algorithms and artificial intelligence to those communities and helping us think through the ideas of where the algorithms are, where we're encountering them, what they mean to our lives, and what we might start to do about it, right? So this was downtown Brooklyn at right across the street from the new Whole Foods. And I say that because it's at a crazy crossroads, right? There's kind of old Brooklyn where there's a food pantry across the street. There's the new Whole Foods. There's BAM. There's this weird confluence of people. And that's what made this space lovely because basically it was a storefront where we came together and A, had conversations, right? So this is a group of people who came and we were talking about empathy and ethics and artificial intelligence and what that actually means to us, because you hear these gigantic ideas and it remains this kind of bubbling thing versus something that we can think about in concrete ways and ways that we might even try to affect in terms of what's going forward, right? So this idea of self-determined representations. It was also this space, which was an installation, but the installation was really an aside because it became this space where people, A, sometimes just sat around and thought about things. But these are young men who are in the space. They go through recess art, and they're being diverted from the criminal justice system. And they had to be there. So sometimes they look kind of bored. But sometimes when you talk to them later, they go, oh, the algorithm that did that, and they're thinking about these things, right? So it's very interesting to be in a space with folks who don't necessarily know why they're thinking about algorithms, talk to them about algorithms, talk to them about algorithms in a very technical way, in a way using systems that are available to all of us online, but also then in a way about, well, you know, that set of decisions you just made is a kind of algorithm for living. And what happens if you make one tiny change to a set of decisions? And thinking, trying to make and affect that change in their lives in that way. It also led to things like this. And this was after a talk we had about the transmission of culture and what algorithms might be from past in terms of dance. So this is a video that I cannot not show, only because A, this young man you know, he's showing all moves that are OG. He said, oh, these are all OG moves. Somebody else taught him that. And somebody else taught that person that. And it's this idea of the kind of passing down and over of culture and what that means, and then moving that into the idea of how you think about algorithms and AI in your life and what you need to be doing to affect that and make small changes in it. And this is Matthew, who is another guy who's being diverted. But with Matthew, we made a bot, right? So, and we were thinking around the idea of what happens if you use tools that are available to you, use your language and things you're very interested in. So Matthew made a sarcastic hip-hop bot about Jedi mind tricks. I don't know exactly what that means, except I do know that Matthew made this thing that talks to him and his friends in a language that they understand. I know that he now understands that system, and that thinking through that system allows him to talk to others about that system, which he does readily, and it's kind of amazing. And I'll just come back to one other thing, because I had the opportunity, again, in terms of affecting or finding ways to affect systems. I got to sit down with Bina Aspin and talk to her about the racial issues that I found missing in the robot, right? And we did that so that in the next brain upgrade for Bina 48, that data will be put in. And it's interesting because Bina 48 kind of represents how Bina Aspin thinks. And you have to dig with Bina Aspin to get to the stuff. But it's there, right? And so this idea of uncovering that and trying to figure out what that means and what kind of representations that requires in artificial intelligences and what nuances are required becomes a really interesting project. And then I will end by asking you all the question I ask everybody, which is, what does artificial intelligence need from you and I and all of us? And how do we need to be thinking about this technological mesh that we are making of the future? And as Kate was asking, right, what is the future we want, and how are we going to create it? Thank you.
Thank you. Next video, introducing.
Social goods like clean water and food, equitable education and healthcare, and meaningful work and civil life are within our grasp. We can build an economic system that benefits forests instead of benefiting those who destroy them. We can design political processes that reward community builders while de-incentivizing acts of community destruction. Perhaps AI can help us here. The social goods that we dream of emerge from an inclusive worldview that rejects social domination and the panicked masculine reflex to reach for weapons of individual and mass destruction. It is closed-fisted fear that bars us from living in homes free of domestic violence. Closed-minded fear bullies communities with invented ethnic and gender discrimination. This fear prioritizes military funding for unfriendly AI to automate mass surveillance, facial recognition, and remote warfare. If AI could identify authoritarian personalities and restrict their use of fists, guns, or bombs, that would be an enormous social good.
We can think of AI to develop personalized treatments and intervention strategies as revolving around two axes of fairness. Fairness in the study design and fairness in the data used to inform our AI algorithms for defining such intervention policies. So before we can even start thinking of ways to ensure that AI does not introduce new forms of inequality and discrimination in healthcare, there are a number of hard questions we need to ask ourselves. Firstly, we need to ask ourselves, is our study design fair? Are we putting people at the center of the healthcare problem we want to solve? What are the potential sectors of society that could become more marginalized if we introduce unfair algorithms? What would the corrective actions we put in place be should we find that an algorithm is unfair? Next, we need to ask ourselves, is the data we are using to inform these algorithms for decisions in health a fair representation of the general population? What does diversity and inclusion in the data set mean? If we have data sets that are biased in any way, not only will our AI algorithms be biased, but also these algorithms will have the potential to amplify the biases contained in our already biased data set. it's really important that we think deeply about these questions to ensure that we use AI to improve health for everyone.
Thank you. I also wanted to tell you that Ajay Revels, who did the first video of these two, is here in the audience. So thank you, Ajay. Great job. And Rediet, please. Rediet Abebe.
Great. Can you guys hear me fine?
Good. Okay. Thank you to the organizers for putting together such a wonderful event. I'm really excited to be here, and I'm really honored to follow you, Kate, and Stephanie, and all the videos that we've seen today. So I'm going to tell you about two initiatives that I've had the honor of co-founding and co-organizing over the past couple of years. But I'm going to start with a personal story, if you don't mind. Oh, how does it go next? Okay, there it is. Okay, so when I arrived at Cambridge, Massachusetts as a freshman in college in the fall of 2009, I was very excited to learn about this new city that would be my home for the next 4 years. I was a regular attendee of the Cambridge Public School and City Council meetings that were held in Cambridge City Hall, which is this beautiful building in the middle of Central Square. At these meetings, I learned about the impact that I learned about the issues that impacted the city's residents and chatted with city council and school committee members at the weekly meetings. And I went on to write about many of these meetings and interactions that I had in our college newspaper. So this is a screenshot of one article that I wrote, which was a long feature. As I learned more, I was surprised to find that Cambridge public schools were really struggling in many ways. They faced issues including a budget deficit, organizational difficulties, and perhaps most notably, an achievement gap. Cambridge Public Schools, located in a city which was home to Harvard and MIT, had a wide race and socioeconomic-based achievement gap. Black, Hispanic, low-income students were underperforming their peers, and there were many reasons for this. One prominent reason was the difference in the quality of education offered at the 11 K-8 public schools and the algorithms that were being used to assign students to public schools. At the time, the school system was even accused of supporting racially and socioeconomically isolating learning environments. Now, I myself was no stranger to stark inequalities in access to education. In fact, I had flown halfway across the world just that fall precisely for this reason. I was born and raised in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, and I grew up with limited access to opportunities and resources. But I was driven by my passion for mathematics, and I also had a very strong support system. So with these advantages and a whole lot of luck, I was able to find my way to Harvard College in the fall of 2009. But what I hadn't expected was to arrive at this city, which is one of the most educated cities in the world, and find that Black and low-income students such as myself were performing 2, 3, 4 years below their grade levels. And I was especially alarmed that systems that were being used to assign students to public schools might be a culprit in perpetuating and exacerbating socioeconomic inequalities that exist in the city. Over the years, we've gained a deeper understanding of how techniques from algorithms and AI can maintain and amplify already existing inequalities. But the other side of this coin is that these techniques, in conjunction with the social sciences and philosophy, can help us better understand socioeconomic inequalities and inform interventions to mitigate it. For the school assignment processes, for instance, mechanisms attuned to racial and economic inequality and the varied needs the students have can and have been used to improve access to education. However, in many domains, there are still major opportunities for exploration. These include improving access to education, allocation of low-income housing or other scarce resources, expanding access to healthcare and health information, quantifying dimensions of inequality that have been historically very hard to measure, and many, many other areas that impact low-income people, people of color, women, and other marginalized communities. And part of the gap between what can be done with AI and what has been done so far is part of the gap, part of the reason why we have this gap is due to the lack of diversity and inclusion within the field of AI. Despite the fact that the field has been growing very rapidly, many international AI conferences that attract thousands of researchers are often attended by only a handful of Black researchers. So it's no surprise that issues that might impact our communities have been explored a lot less than they should have been. And to address these issues, along with Timnit Gebru, Mustafa Sisi, Sami Kwejo, and many others, we co-founded the Black in AI group about a year ago. The group started as a very small Facebook group among a group of friends and friends of friends. But now it's grown to have over 600 members who live in 5 different continents. This past December, we organized the first Black in AI workshop at the Conference on Neural Information Processing Systems, or NIPS, which is the largest machine learning conference. The workshop was attended by nearly 200 members of the Black in AI community. And here's a picture of a subset of the Ethiopian attendees at NIPS. And I think that there were more Ethiopian attendees at NIPS this year than there were Black attendees combined in previous years. And at this conference, we had over 200 members of the Black in AI community. We showcased the work of over 70 Black researchers in AI. And students who flew halfway across the world were able to talk to leaders in the AI community and share their work with them. Now, this was one small way to foster the inclusion of Black researchers in this increasingly influential field. But this important work continues. Black in AI is growing rapidly, and members are forming transcontinental collaborations. Many of us are working on problems that impact our community specifically. But in addition to Black in AI, I'm also a co-founder and co-organizer of the Mechanism Design for Social Good group with Kira Goldner. Mechanism Design for Social Good is an interdisciplinary, multi-institutional group with the goal of finding problems where insights from algorithms and AI have the potential to improve access to opportunity, and especially for groups of people who've been traditionally overlooked. We were inspired by the power that these techniques have to improve societal welfare, and we wanted to investigate domains where there remain major opportunities for exploration and build off of previous work that underlies success stories. And we're especially dedicated to approaching these problems from an interdisciplinary perspective. What started as a very small exploratory group in the fall of 2016 has now grown into a much broader effort. We have a network of nearly 100 researchers across multiple institutions involved in this initiative at various levels. We organized workshops at the ACM Conference of Economics and Computation, which was held at MIT last year and will be held at Cornell this year. And to ensure that our work has impact both within the academy and beyond, we're exploring collaborations with policymakers, NGOs, and other entities with a shared mission. So if you're in this audience and you're interested in learning more, please don't hesitate to reach out to me. Both Mechanism Design for Social Good and Black in AI are initiatives aimed at fostering collaborations between individuals with a diverse set of experiences, expertise, and interests. Ensuring that algorithms and AI work for all of society will, I believe, hinge on our ability to leverage the immense potential that these kinds of collaborations have. Thank you.
You want to start the switching? The next videos?
A very common plot in this regard are machines that are going crazy and even taking over the rule. We see two arguments for that. One is a religious one. In most Christian religions, it is forbidden for man to be godlike. There are numerous examples for breaches of this regulation in the Bible. A very similar pattern is repeated by numerous science fiction stories and also in several versions of the Frankenstein narrative. Our hypothesis is that this pattern is based on our Christian religious cultural history. It is similar in all Abrahamic religions. The second aspect is the experience of the Industrial Revolution in Europe beginning in the 19th century. The technical development resulted in a dominance of machines which often was felt as a threat. There was a kind of technophobia which even resulted in fights against machines. In England, there was a movement which destroyed weaving machines, which became so grave that the Parliament decided demolition of machines to be a capital crime. Looking to Asia, in particular Japan, we find a very different stance on robots. Eastern religions are animistic religions, claiming that everything has a spiritual essence. This even holds for dead objects and hints for robots. Nishimura, a Japanese pioneer in robotics, put it already in 1928 in the following way: if humans are the children of nature, then artificial humans, hence robots, are the grandchildren of nature.
I was presented with this question about humans and if we can learn about our bodies using AI. And I see this sort of as the same question of if you ask someone if they can learn about their bodies using magic. I mean, magic is a space that doesn't have a meaning yet, but it's inherently valuable. I mean, magic, like AI, and to some extent our bodies, I think are things that generally work well or work seamlessly, and we kind of don't know why they work or why they fail. So the systems run behind a curtain, but they work or they don't, right? And we don't always understand the mechanisms behind that. And I wanted to sort of challenge this notion of AI art and the notion of AI as a system, and what does those systems look like with the series I just recently did alone together. So I wanted to make work specifically that was like hyper traditionally analog, using painting and canvas and no electronics kind of in the actual execution of the installation. But I was really interested in using a really modern tool set to execute those works. And so when you paint with a brush, it's so much about precision and kind of control. But with AI and using, robotic vacuum cleaner, I saw so much about the compositions of the work as kind of being this loss of control. And so I was very curious about thinking about these questions about where humans are and where they aren't, and sort of drawn to this obsession of documentation of existence, and existence of something, if it's online or off, does it happen? And sort of what does a selfie look like if you don't have a camera? You know, it's sort of this unselfie in a way. It's about being physically present and claiming space while also being completely absent at the same time.
Oh, Addy, if you're awake and live stream, thank you. So thanks a lot. And I would like now to call first Fernanda, and then, oh, you're staying here next to each other for each, oh, that's great. It's always a choreography that I love. So Fernanda Viegas and Martin Wattenberg.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Paola, and thank you, Erica. We're delighted to be here.
Yes. We're going to, there's a lot to talk about, so we're going to go fast.
Yes, and we might cut on the fly. Let's see your AI do that. That's the real Turing test. Okay.
All right, so we're going to rush.
We're going to skip.
Yes.
We're going to miss the historical intro.
Thing. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
You're going to miss the historical.
This is the right kind of audience to do that.
Okay. So Martin and I co-lead an initiative at Google called PAIR, People Plus AI Research. And part of the motivation for that is to bring interdisciplinarity, as has been mentioned already here, into the field of machine learning and AI in general. And so very specifically, we're bringing design thinking, and also we're bringing HCI, human-computer interaction, into how do you build, how do you think, how do you design machine learning systems. And so what PAIR does, it does a couple of different things. One is we do fundamental research in applied machine learning. How do you make machine learning systems that work in the way that they should work for, say, doctors or musicians or architects? We also create tools and educational experiences. So we create tools that we use internally at Google, and then eventually, and if they work well, we open source them. And so that's one of the things that gets us really excited. And then we also do events and outreach.
Okay, so.
Oh yeah,
this is
I'm you. Back, I'm back
because
on, okay.
We cut, we're a little all right. Here.
So as has been said many, many times, data is key. And you now all know why data is so key, because basically the system only knows what it has seen and what it has ingested, right? And so part of the complication here is that that's a new paradigm for building systems. If you are a developer, you were used to building your system and then running it, compiling it. Now, to create systems in AI, you need to really be careful, really understand your data set. Trick is, there are no good tools for looking at massive amounts of data. So that's one of the challenges that we're starting to address in PAIR. So let me give you a sense of a tool we created to actually look at data. So this is called Facets, and what we're looking at here is one of the Hello World
data sets of AI, which is called CIFAR-10, which is nothing more than images in 10 different categories. These are things that have been labeled by humans. And just by doing that, just that, is super hard to do if you don't have a tool. So, and just by doing that, I can already see differences in hues. I can see that, you know, airplanes look bluer than, say, birds, and that kind of makes sense. I can very quickly start zooming in and actually visually inspect my data set. And this is where things could start to, you could start to see problems. It could be that half of your data set is blank, and you don't even know. You're just training it, right? So just having this ability to just inspect things visually is huge. And then you can start playing different games. I can see, okay, what is the hue distribution for these different classes, for all these pictures that I'm training on? I can also do things like what's called a confusion matrix. This is a way of telling what humans think are on these photos, so you can see the labels at the top. And then on the side there, what my system think is on the photo. So good news for me is that the diagonal is the most populated part there. That is the place where humans and machine agree, right? But now what I'm gonna do is I'm going to take out that entire diagonal. And now I have all the mistakes that my system is making, all right? And just by doing that again, I can already start to see, oh, okay, so these are the cells that are highly, highly populated. These are the places where my system is getting really confused. And it seems like it is where dogs and cats meet. So my system is getting very confused about dogs and cats. All right, that gives me a clue. Maybe I need more data on dogs and cats so that my system does better. So again, just having these tools to just look at things very quickly is incredibly useful. So this is something we started using internally at Google and then open sourced. It's something called Facets. And the thing that was super interesting to see is how people are using the tool in different ways to look at things like fairness. How does it do for gender, different genders, different races? What is the distribution of your data set?
So that tells you a little bit about data, but you could also ask about what's called the model. Okay, so you can think about the training data as kind of the life experiences of an AI. The model is a little bit like its brain. That's where the thinking, to the extent that it is thinking, is happening. And we want to talk a little bit about how you might peer inside of a model. Now, part of the issue here is that the way the models think is in terms of high-dimensional space. They think geometrically. Let's talk about this and break it down. So we're going to do a warm-up. It's with a data set. It's with something called MNIST. This is a data set of handwritten images. It's actually something that's giving Lena a run for the money on most common images. And this is something that machine learning researchers use to try to train systems to recognize, you know, this basically a database of like all the weird ways that humans have written zeros and ones and twos and so forth, and to train a system to recognize a zero from a one, no matter how a human might write it, okay? So the idea is to turn these things into geometry. And how do we do that? Well, we turn it into geometry with operation that's familiar to computer scientists or anyone who's gotten very close to a computer screen. You blow an image up into its individual pixels, like black, gray, white, like this. You assign them a number between 0 and 1. And then you just list all the numbers, all the brightnesses of the different pixels, and that gives you a vector. Okay? And this is where it starts to get a little bit tricky. Instead of the familiar vectors of 2 or 3 dimensions, these, in this case, it's 784 pixels, so it's 784 dimensions. But you've done something so far. You've turned the image into a point in some high-dimensional space. And you can turn different images into different points. Now, why do we even bother doing this? The answer is this allows the computer to actually start making comparisons between these and computing with them in a way that's very much like thinking. And what we want to do is show you a visualization of what even the 784 dimensional space looks like. So obviously, we don't have 784 dimensional brains. This is going to be hard to see. But what we do have is we have a variety of techniques to take the shapes from those high dimensions and put them into 3 dimensions where we as humans can understand. And it looks something like this. Now, I'm going to do one little thing here, which is I'm going to color these by the labels. So different digits, as labeled by humans, will get different colors. That makes it look a little bit better. And it also helps us understand that in this geometry, suddenly, these digits have like gotten into little clumps that you could sort of think with. Moreover, if you look at those little clumps very carefully, you can actually start to see things. For example, here are all the ones. And if you look carefully, you'll see you're going from left slanting ones to right slanting ones. Just through the magic of geometrization, we've been able to actually make some sense of these images and put them into sort of a sliding scale. So this gives you an introduction to how you might take sort of the geometry that a computer thinks with and put it into visuals. Now let's see how we can use that to actually look at a model.
Another thing I want to call out here, just very quickly, is that I can start to play with this and click on things and see, oh, these are the nearest neighbors. And this is really important when you're dealing with systems and you're trying to understand how well a system is functioning. How well does it cluster things together? So the thing I want to do next is go from this very specific, again, hello world problem of MNIST and talk about a production system at Google. And how do we do machine learning interpretability there? So the system we're going to talk about is translation. I'm sure everybody here must have, at one point or another, looked into translation. About a year and a half ago, Google came out with something called the multilingual translation systems. And these were really amazing systems because it was the first time you could input multiple languages and you could translate or output multiple other languages. And the other thing that was really interesting was this notion of zero-shot translation. So if I gave a system just training data, again, training data is key, things between English and Japanese, so I have those pairings, English, Japanese, Japanese, English, and I have English, Korean, Korean, English. All right, that's all the data it's ever seen. Somehow these systems would then be able to translate between Japanese and Korean in high quality translations. That's what's called zero shot. It never saw training data for that specific direction. So the question in the researchers' minds, the people who were building these systems, is what is that high dimensional space of languages in these multilingual systems? How are these systems resolving these multiple languages? Is it something more like what you see here on the left, where imagine I am coloring each language by a different color, and I see that I have a neighborhood that is all English here in green, and a neighborhood that's all Japanese in blue, and another one that's all Korean in yellow? Or is the scenario more like what you see on the right, where these languages are coming together and they're clustering based on meaning? So the system doesn't care as much that I have a string that says home and another string that says casa. Somehow, those are very different strings, and yet the system knows they are related because it cares about the semantic meaning, all right? Why do we care about that? We care about that because if indeed what was happening was something closer to what you see on the right there, these are the first indications that the system might be doing something, might be learning some kind of interlingua or universal language, okay? And so what was happening? What was the case? So to understand what was happening, we worked with the researchers and created a visualization. What does a visualization of that look like? Imagine I want to visualize this sentence. The stratosphere extends from 10 kilometers to 50 kilometers in altitude. Think about the image, okay. Think about the image Martin just showed you with the dots, with the images, right? It could look something like this. What I do is I connect those dots, I have my sentence. Now when I translate that sentence, do they look like this separate because they're separate languages, or do they look like this? So very quickly, this is the system that has Japanese, Korean, and English. Do you see different neighborhoods of different colors here? No. So that's the first kind of hint that this was actually clustering on the semantic meaning, okay? And so this was a scientific breakthrough because it was the first time we saw a system that could actually understand things at a much higher level. So I just connected. I just clicked on the stratosphere sentence here, and you can see the nearest neighbors. They're all clustered there. Very quickly, a sister system that had Portuguese, French, Portuguese, Spanish, and English had a very different situation here with a whole neighborhood of red. We went back and looked at this with the translation researchers, and they ran a statistical analysis and found out that all that red was low quality translation. Why does that matter? Because it tells us that the geometry of these spaces matter. And if it's not clustering, it's not working. Okay? So again, a notion of why does it matter to look into and understand what these systems are doing?
Okay, I don't know what we did.
Yeah. So we're going to end with a very rapid fire tour of a couple of things we're doing. Other things that we do, we're trying to bring more stakeholders into the space. We have, you know, we've talked about machine learning fairness so far here several times. One of the things we've tried to do is help people who are not traditional computer scientists understand some of the trade-offs involved, some of the technicalities. It's important that everyone be able to talk about this. Another thing, in addition to, you know, and we've done this in a variety of ways, is we're trying to bring machine learning to the web. This is an interesting example.
Humor.
We're essentially, there's sort of an interesting point about technicalities here, that the traditional languages of machine learning are Python, C++, so forth. Certainly Google put out TensorFlow, library for machine learning, those are the main languages. But JavaScript is the language that many people use to use, you know, on the web and so forth. It's a whole other community. So one of the things we've tried to do in our group is to create JavaScript libraries, and now we have TensorFlow.js recently announced, that allow people to do powerful machine learning in the browser. This is something that actually, when people first started doing it, people thought it was like a little crazy to use JavaScript for this. But the point here is that these technical capabilities directly tie into different communities on the web. And what you see is that here's a fantastic thing from some people who are in the audience right now, Teachable Machine. And we've seen people, you know, Oz Ramos, you know, someone who's not, you know, someone we knew at all, use these capabilities in JavaScript to create this fantastic accessibility tool for one of his friends. So by bringing a different set of technical tools, we've brought in an entirely new community. I think we'll end with the idea that we can learn from computers. And here's an odd little story. It's the story of AlphaZero. So AlphaZero is a chess engine created by DeepMind. It's maybe the strongest chess player ever. But that is not the story. The story is a story of romance. And you might say, where is the romance in chess? And the answer, if you're a chess player, is this. This is move 30 of a famous game, and this is the equivalent of Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers dancing, if you are a chess player. I won't go into why, but like, this is fantastic. And you don't have to trust me on this, on why it's fantastic. It's very easy, if you type in Alpha Zero and romance or beauty, to find all these quotes, both from the press and just from people asking questions on sites, where they're like, wow, what is going on with this? You know, how can it play in such a romantic style? And I think this bottom quote is really interesting. This is just from a chess forum online. And you see someone saying, this is incredibly interesting to be online. This is the first example I've seen in my life of something that's computer generated and also has deep beauty. One of the reasons I think this is important is because it short circuits what I think is a fairly flat narrative at this point of human versus machine. You might think, you know, there's sort of a cliche of like, oh, this machine got really good at chess and now the humans are sad. No, if you talk to actual chess players, they are fantastically happy. They love it. It's beautiful. And I think it's important to remember this when we talk about that kind of conflict.
And then just the last thought, is there more to romance from in terms of learning? Can we learn back from any of these things that are happening in AI? One of the things that has given us a lot of inspiration is some of the medical advances. It turns out that a system built by a team at Brain got so good at identifying diabetic retinopathy that it started doing things that doctors can't do. So by looking at the fundus image, this is what doctors look at to understand retinopathy. This system was also able to pick out things that doctors can't, like the gender of the person, or the age, or the cardiovascular risk factor of the person. And to this day, we're not quite sure how it's doing it, but we're working on, again, interpretability techniques so that we can learn back, so that doctors can learn back. And this is something that has become very powerful. We've worked with an earthquake scientist who is now using machine learning to try to understand how can we predict, how can we better predict earthquakes. So just gonna leave you with this notion that it's not only they can learn, we can learn back too. Thank you.
So let's sit together. So I have Reddy here, Martin, you're there. And then who remembers all the, next to Martin, there was Kate. Yeah, you know all of your seats perfectly. Thank you so much. So one of the secrets of these salons, it's a little bit with the diet for longevity that keeps mice in a very under-caloric diet every day. So it's, we leave you always wanting for more with frustration. I have to say that every single one of these presentations could have gone on forever. And I wanted to ask you all, can all this different information be found on your websites? Can people find more? Yeah. But so just research more afterwards. I like it. I like very much how a lot of what we discussed tonight was about going backwards, thinking first and foremost of the future that we want, the people that we want to be, and then taming, studying, designing, forming the technology to go towards those particular goals. It's beautiful. It's real design. It's about trying to, maybe the goals can be revised afterwards, but in a way, that's where we want to go. But when we talk about AI becoming more human, what kind of human are we thinking of? I mean, it's not Lena. It's who, what is the model that we're thinking of? And does anybody ever discuss this kind of complex truth? Kate, do you know? Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think the first part of that question is to ask, who is we? Who is the we who's deciding, you know, how AI is going to become more human or not? And I think what's really interesting is to think about just how concentrated AI companies are in the world right now. We're talking about really between 5 to 7 companies doing this at scale. So as much as that there are really interesting tools that I think, you know, Martin Ferner showed us some really interesting ones, the way that power is concentrated at scale to do real large-scale infrastructural AI is actually very, very small people, very small numbers of people with their hands on the levers.
Very small people.
Very could be small. Got to be careful. We won't mention any names. But what is interesting here is to think about who's making those decisions. So we are talking about a very small number of people in the sort of elite ranks of people who decide how AI works. That's the first thing to take in mind. The second thing to think is about this idea of humanity, I think, is a very profound one. Because, again, if you're building AI that looks like you or that relates to your concerns, it's actually very difficult for people to put themselves in the shoes of completely different populations and other sides of the world and to say, is the experience of being human actually fundamentally different? And I would suggest that it is. I think this is where we have to ask harder philosophical questions here rather than assuming we know what it is to be human. Yeah. And know what it is to be intelligent.
No, of course. And I want to come back to you with the asking you about government. But as to this question that Kate just raised, what it means to be human in different cultures and in different countries, how did you tackle that? I mean, just starting Black in AI is a way to position yourself, but also you're from Ethiopia, so you are from another part of the world. I'm sure that you're dealing with different data sets of what it means to be a human. So how do you, as a computer scientist, think of this?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a really interesting question. Are you asking me personally, or just Black in AI in general? Or
well, I was asking you as a founder of Black in AI, yeah, and also as an Ethiopian woman, yeah, as an Ethiopian woman that moved to Cornell. You know, so
yeah,
as a complex, a culturally complex person, as we all are, but with your own kind of data sets.
Yeah, I think that Kate's point is a really good one, right? Which is that I think we're interested, like what we're interested in is impacted by our identities, who we are, what experiences we've had, right? And so, you know, one of the things that I noticed when I first arrived to the U.S. was that I cared a lot about poverty issues, and I cared a lot about education, and I cared a lot about what was going on in the developing world, and all these things. And that was largely because of my experiences, the experiences that I've had, right? And so when I learned something, I think, okay, how can this be helpful to alleviate poverty? How can this be helpful to improve access to opportunity for, you know, these groups of people or whatever it is, right? And so I think that is why we have to be very careful that whenever there's a concentration of power, those who have access to that power, that it's a diverse group of people, because they'll be asking very different questions.
And that goes back to what Kate was talking about. Yeah.
And I think that, you know, it's not even, you don't even have to like necessarily assume malice, right? I think that people mm-hmm. just have different biases. And when you have a group of people who have correlated biases and have a lot of power, that can be really bad. And so we thought that, you know, just diversifying the AI community, just having a lot of people there who would not normally show up at these conferences was extremely important. And that's why we started the Black and AI community, and also the workshop. And I'll say that, you know, increasing diversity often involves a lot of work. I mean, it involves a lot of work. It involves a lot of giving up power and yielding it to someone else. It involves a lot of listening. I think it involves a lot of trying to understand what people care about and why they care about it. And there are different ways of doing things.
Sorry if I interrupt. Mm-hmm, I just wanted to connect these two questions. Kate and Radiet, can governments be the guarantors of this kind of diversity in the... No, but you've just come back from a tour of Europe. We know that... European governments tend to be more hands-on when it comes to legislation and control, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So what did you get from that tour? And
I mean, I think tour makes it sound much cooler than it was.
It was
just one of those strange coincidences that a set of governments are all, well, it's not a coincidence, it's because these technologies are affecting so many things simultaneously many countries in Europe are really concerned about what they see as essentially the fact that there are two big AI players right now, which is the US and China, and what is the role that Europe is going to play. And this is a really good time for Europe, I think, to be asking that question. Mm-hmm. And partly the question is about what are the sort of the standards? How do we want to play in this field? Do we want to extract lots of data from our population in order to start to create large-scale training data sets? Or is there another way? Can you do that using differential privacy? Can you use that using regulation that protects issues around discrimination, around privacy invasion? So it's an extremely tense and interesting time in Europe. We're about to see the GDPR, which is a very major piece of legislation around data protection, just come into effect in May. And so everyone's thinking about it over there. And I think we can't leave these things totally in the hands of governments. I think there's a lot of reasons why we'd have questions about that here in the US. But what I think we can do is really start to support the communities who are in those countries, starting to say, we want accountability. We want transparency of how these systems work. And this is something, in fact, that the AI Now Institute has been working on. The reason we were there was because we've been working on a thing called algorithmic impact assessments that essentially governments could use to say, if you are going to deploy one of these large-scale AI systems to decide who gets out of jail or who gets healthcare, you have to be able to show people how that decision was made. You have to be able to allow them to see the data that's being used about them and to see how that system is processing that data. We don't even have those guarantees here in the US. And I think it's incredibly important to start thinking about what sort of guardrails can we put in place to make sure that communities actually have some due process with these systems. And Europe's having that conversation right now.
You want to say something?
Yeah, right? So I think this is an incredibly important point. And I think part of what I see in the conversations you're alluding to is that we need to empower people to sort of talk about these things sensibly. Mm-hmm. It's critical that to the extent that government intervenes, it does it in a way that makes sense. We know what it looks like to when a government decides that it has an answer it has in mind that is its desired world, and it doesn't use science to get there. And we've seen it with climate science. You know, you may decide, oh, I want a world where, you know, the oil companies have free rein, and I'll ignore scientists. That's bad, I think. And I think the same thing is true here, that in order to make good decisions about how to kind of keep AI accountable, to keep all the players accountable, you also need the technical knowledge. So this is one of the things we think about a lot at PEAR, is how do we educate people? How do we broaden the set of stakeholders who can talk about this? Because the important thing is that everyone should be able to sort of have a part of the conversation, and it takes a certain amount of education in order to do that. I think that's critical.
Let me ask Stephanie about this, because art can do a lot to kind of break the ice sometimes, you know, science or technology. Sometimes it's the opposite. Sometimes it's art that is intimidating. But art can get under the skin, especially the kind of art that you do. We were discussing the system with acupuncture nodes. So where does your work put the needle?
So I think that my work is very much about this, right? And having the belief that there are spaces and communities, and that communities have the willingness to talk about this, sometimes need some broadening of education so that they can talk about it more knowledgeable. But one of the things that was very interesting that would happen in that space that I was in was people were willing to walk in the door and just start talking about AI in crazy ways, right? Sometimes that was very much about pop culture, kind of robot, you know, big crazy things. But then you back that up and you start using that as the entry point for broader, more detailed, nuanced conversation. And that was a possibility. And so I feel that there's this point of, you know, getting people to the table so that the needles can start to go in becomes super important. And I really think that it's hyper important that we are having these conversations and that we believe that people are capable of them, because there feels to me this line where it's like, well, this is so complicated, people can't necessarily do this.
Yeah, without condescension. Fernanda, do you want to say?
I was going to say it to that point. I think, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that has been really interesting is how do you talk about some of the technical trade-offs or the technicalities? For instance, everybody talks about machine learning fairness. Fairness, we all want fairness. And yes, we all want fairness. How do you actually operationalize that? What does that mean, really? And so there, very quickly, you start understanding things like there are multiple definitions of what it means to be fair. And you can't have all of them in the same system. So one of the things that we did that I thought was really powerful, to your point of you can't dumb down the message, and you need to find ways of welcoming a broader set of stakeholders to the conversation. We did a visualization of different definitions of fairness and how that would affect multiple populations at the same time. So that was translating a lot of math, heavy math, into a visualization that you could play with and a simulation. And it went viral, and we started getting emails. So for instance, from criminal justice departments in the US saying, can we build something like this so that we can have a conversation in our own department about the trade-offs when we are using algorithms, right? And I feel like that is exactly what you want. You want to be able to welcome, not everybody speaks the heavy math, but that's okay, they don't have to. There are different ways that we can start communicating some of the subtleties.
Yeah, I have to say that your presentation was stunning. I mean, everybody here in the DICE has a very important role in this whole universe and landscape, not only of AI, but also of educating governments, people, companies in AI. It's quite fascinating. Were you about to say something, Radiant?
No.
So, and there are also people in the audience that also do their part. So I would like to open it up to you, because there are so many amazing people. Ajay, are you still here? You're over there. I didn't even see you. So would you like to contribute something? I mean, your video is really quite powerful. And maybe you want to say something more, too.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me. I would really love to ask the panelists to think about. I think I work in software and worked in software for about 17 years, and I find that the problem isn't the technology, the problem is actually the human beings. And I really think that one of the reasons I wanted to make this video was to actually just point to, I have fantasies around wanting to release AI that can actually go out and find criminals, that can actually go out and distribute wealth, and I feel like we could do that. But I would love to hear your response on where we could actually be making the most impact in cultures. I'm skeptical that software can save us. I really think that human beings need to be retrained in a way, and maybe AI can be used to do that.
Okay, so who wants to? You can all say yours. I would like. Let's start with Stephanie. Yeah.
Well, I'll
I agree with you. It's the people. I'll say, I have a short story. So I went to a meeting about 40 people in AI, real people that I wasn't quite sure how I got in that room. And it was quite interesting to me because I did a 5-minute lightning talk. And at the end of my talk, I said, and I will say that I was the only black person and the representative artist in the room. I said, I would like you all to take a moment and imagine what it's like to be me in this room, and then make a gesture that symbolizes what that, whatever comes to mind is. And it was super interesting because I could see heads starting to pop off of shoulders. Like, you could just see, like, they did not know what to do with this idea of empathizing in that way and having to step out of where they were and into where I was, whatever that meant to them. And that idea of not being able to even, like, go through an exercise really crystallized for me, right? Like, how important it is, like, we need to deal with each other as people so that we can then deal with each other as people who deal with each other through machines, right? just amazing. So I'm with you on that.
It's funny. I guess, I love that point, Stephanie, and I think there's this other issue when we think about what would AI look like if you just unleashed it and could do its own thing, because we can never see that. It is so expensive to build an AI system. It is so costly. There is so much capital sort of intensive behind any of these systems that you're seeing. Is that really when we're talking about AI, we're talking about late capitalism. That's actually what we're talking about and how that functions. And in the end, the way the corporate structure works right now is that a company has one guiding responsibility, which is to maximize shareholder value. And AIs are systems that optimize. What they do is extremely clever pattern recognition and optimization. So what you've got is a set of tools that are really good at optimizing and a set of companies that have one motive, which is to maximize profits. So what you have there, I think, is a really dangerous combination, which is you have a doubling of optimizations, which are really not about how do we address, you know, maximizing the happiness of all or addressing inequality. We're actually looking at a type of corporate power that I think is something that a lot of people are concerned about.
There's no not-for-profits that
So I disagree a little bit with this idea that you need vast resources to do AI. In fact, I don't think that's true. There are certain cases where maybe you do, and you know, vast resources can be helpful, but there's certainly been a huge amount of work done in academia that has been basically led to the current breakthroughs we see now that have been those breakthroughs.
That's if you think that academia is independent.
And I think one thing that's very interesting is that if you look at, for example, there's been interesting work from John Kleinberg and others. From your collaborators. What happens if you look at criminal justice and, say, setting bail algorithmically, but try to do it extremely carefully, okay? And this is something that's an incredibly tricky area in general, and we've seen it done very, very badly in some cases. But there's interesting evidence that perhaps you could do it in a way that is not so bad, that in fact, perhaps could improve on humans. And again, I phrase this tentatively because it's important to have the right caveats there. However, it's equally important not to assume it cannot be done, because one of the things we're learning through AI is it's kind of holding up a mirror to people. And it often tells us just how biased we are. You know, we could complain about an algorithm making a decision, but judges are very biased too sometimes. And so I think that many of these experiments actually do not take huge resources. A lot of times they take a certain amount of, you know, you have to have the idea to do it and the willingness to do it. But I think we should keep an open mind about what's possible. And I think there's actually a lot that can be done by individuals.
Can I put the needle? Sure. Okay. Mm-hmm. I agree with you, Martin, that I think academics do have perhaps more flexibility and I think ability to explore whatever it is that we might want to study, right? And you know, many of my colleagues have. I will say, was it during Stephanie's presentation that we had those graphs, right? Like at these different companies and how diverse they are. And I'll just add that academia is not that much more diverse either, yeah. Right? So even though we might have more freedom, more flexibility, more ability to do whatever it is that we want to do and study, again, if you have these correlated biases and preferences and values, then you're still going to be exploring like the same kinds of problems, right? So I will just add that you know, diversity within academia is definitely an issue that is hindering
that.
Point. Yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And I'd like to add a note of optimism here too. I mean, I think this is the landscape that we're currently in. I mean, the reason why we created the AI Now Institute is precisely because I don't think you can address fairness in the criminal justice system just from a computer science department.
Your computer,
yeah. Just from a computer science department. Yeah. If you want to think about fairness, you can't do it there. You actually need to have people who have come from the law faculty, from sociology, from anthropology. You actually need people in the communities being assessed by these algorithms to have a say in how they're being applied. So, I mean, for me, I as much as I'm very familiar with Kleinberg's paper, I think we have a lot further to go to really start thinking about what real fairness is, what those multiple definitions might look like. So I think we can do it, but I think we need to create interdisciplinary spaces. We need to have real talk conversations about how power operates through AI, and we need to start thinking about ways in which people get to participate in these systems.
Absolutely.
Because right now it's very hard.
Mm-hmm. True that. Do you need to
agree?
No.
Okay. I will just add that that's where the arts come in. Like one of my next steps in truly is to make an AI. And it's to make an AI that is developed by community, and if anybody wants to help out there.
Will it have a physical presence?
Well, this is an argument in my head right now, and which will be with my collaborators as well, because once you give it that physicality, it becomes this thing that we really place very specific ideas on. Without that, it's a digital consciousness that kind of operates in the world, right? And there are pros and cons to both of those things and how you approach it, but for now, mine is a digital story that becomes through AI, right? And in fact, it'll be a memoir of my family, and we'll see how that goes and what it means to kind of dig that and take that data that is known really well and put it through a system that is massaged by people of color and communities. Yeah. And see
and
what
I agree with you.
Out.
Art can do a lot.
Yeah, I think we can step in
absolutely.
And have some fun.
Are there other good questions in the audience? Okay, I saw you there, and I saw first him, and then I'll come to you. Wait, you need the microphone. It's coming.
I've been reading a lot recently about the social credit system in China that's being developed, or I don't know if it's already in practice.
Social credit.
Yeah.
I don't know about
social
it.
Score. Where you're kind of given a score, and that can impact your ability to like travel and other things, and I guess in the U.S. how. People applying for visas, their social media profiles are screened. Like, I was wondering if any of the panelists had thoughts on the way governments are already using data to like classify people and make decisions.
Okay.
So the social credit system, for people who aren't familiar with this in China, is being beta tested at the moment. It's like a meta credit score of everything that you do. So it tracks what you buy online. If you say something nice about the government, your score goes up. If you're late for work or if you smoke, your score goes down. These scores are actually used if you want to get a loan. They're used when to decide where your kids can go to school. And now we know if you can travel domestically. A recent investigation just a few days ago showed that 12 million Chinese have actually already been stopped from traveling domestically because their social credit score was too low. So I actually think this is really concerning, and to put it politely. But what's interesting, too, is that we have this tendency to say, oh, that's China. It could never happen here.
Yeah.
But actually, a lot of these tools and systems and ways of analyzing and tracking people and modulating everything from your credit score in, you know, everything from your social graph through to whether or not you're going to loan, that can happen here as well and is happening here already. So I think there's a difference here in the way that centralized government can actually deploy these powers, but that doesn't mean that we're not starting to see very similar impacts here, and particularly at the border. This is where we're really starting to see these particular tools brought to bear, and again, brought to bear on people who are the most vulnerable.
Mm-hmm. There was a question over there. Yeah, it was you. It's coming to you.
Hi. I thought the visualization was one of the more interesting pieces of taking the logic behind the algorithms and creating a human interpretation of that higher dimensional space. And I'm very curious if you can begin to use that to look at the, when you said you sort of created a graph of fairness, like, can we begin to look at the existing algorithms and then see how their fairness is changing over time? Because I think that AI does not stop, right? Like, when we talk about training data, it is continuing to move. And so how can we use these techniques to sort of not
to
only...
To also monitor.
Yes,
AIs.
To monitor, yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Fernanda.
Yeah, sure. So is that Philip?
Yes.
Hey,
hi.
Philip.
Hi.
Good to see you. Hi. So, yeah, so in fact, the same technique, the same tool that you saw where we were looking at the translation system, we also looked at the entire language of English, the English language, and we were clustering things. And it very quickly you can start. So there's a thing you can do on that tool where you can create your own axis, your own projection. And so we started playing with it and doing things like, oh, what if we put the words in the English language in an axis that go between woman and man? And what's going to happen there? Very quickly, obviously, you start seeing things like, oh, all the professions that are prototypical male professions, like engineer, are going to be pulled towards the male side of things, and all the, you know, like, and you have poet and teacher and whatever being pulled towards woman. And you can start playing with this over and over again. So biases become, so you can start to see those axes in the visualization very quickly. To your question about, could you start then visualizing the evolution of things? Are they getting better? Are they getting worse? So one of the things we're very curious about, we're starting to work on, are how do you compare these different embeddings? Is it over time, or how do you compare one embedding? So if you have, whatever, the English language during one century versus the English language in a different century, what are the pieces of the English language that moved the most in terms of bias, then can you start analyzing this? But yeah, to your point, we want to start using these visualization tools so that you can start to very clearly see things like biases.
I would just amplify one thing there, which is that, as Fernanda says, you can apply this to geometrization of languages. And so at that point, you're talking about an ingredient to machine learning systems. So that's important for thinking about machine learning fairness. However, what you're also looking at is essentially human biases. And as Fernanda says, you can look at this over time. There's a great paper from Stanford where they were looking at how these embeddings changed. You know, you can look at particular words like gay. How does that change the geometry of that word change over time? And it's incredibly revealing, you know? So it becomes this really interesting tool, ultimately, to study how humans have been changing. And I think this is just a theme that we keep coming back to over and over again, that as we try to make, you know, people try to make machines human, whatever that means, they're forced to question what human means, and mm-hmm. they learn about what human means. Often they learn things maybe they're sad to learn, but it's an interesting process.
Over there, yeah. And then I'll come to you. I've seen you. Mm-hmm. Can you raise your hand again? Oh, you've seen it. Okay, thank you.
Hi. So we're talking about issues of bias and of fairness, and these are sort of bywords in this new debate around AI. And often I see this debate sort of collapse into a discussion of parity, right? If we had all the data from everyone's lives across the world forever, our AI would be perfect, bias would be solved, and we'd be okay. But as with the example of the Chinese credit score or potentially other, you know, insidious uses of this technology, we see that actually kind of a perfect recognition of all people might not promote justice. So when we're talking about AI for the service of people, when we're talking about bias, fairness, how do we also talk about justice where it may need to escape, say, tools for visualizing data or tools for visualizing bias within a system and actually speak to the social, structural systems that the system will be deployed in?
Radia, do you want to take this?
Mm-hmm. Does someone else want to take this? I feel like, Kate, you should take it.
Yeah.
I think you should take it.
Yeah. I was unfair because she was in her thoughts for a moment. So, Kate, you take it, or Stephanie takes it, or
mm-hmm. Stephanie, please. I, look,
Surprise, surprise, I agree with you. look, I mean, I think this is, at the moment, there is a, so it's interesting, you've heard that, you know, that fairness is an issue right now. I mean, I've been working in this field for, you know, I've been publishing papers specifically on fairness and bias for over 7 years, and it's really only just been in the last 18 months that there's been this explosion of interest. And what we're seeing is this desire, I think, to come up with sort of quick technical fixes that will create fairness through parity. It's like, oh, well, as long as everyone is being treated the same by my system, it's fair. And I think there are some real issues there. And again, these questions around not just that there are multiple definitions of fairness, but who gets to decide what version of fairness will affect your life is actually the really key question here. So this deep issue of how do we contend with our own histories, our own historical biases, to move towards justice is actually the most important conversation that we could be having. And the footnote that I would add to that is, like, you're absolutely right, Martin. Humans are biased, so are machines. But humans work within institutions, and institutions have hundreds of years of ways of saying judges have to write out a judgment. You can have an appeal. You can see how a decision was made about you. These are systems that don't have any of those kinds of processes around them.
But we can set them up, right?
We can set them up, but who's holding them to account? You know, and who's making sure that if that decision is made, you have the ability to actually hold that system to account? We don't actually have that yet.
Yeah, that's important. Okay. Was it Tom that was raising his hand? No. No, over there. No. Yeah. Sorry.
First, thank you. You're all amazing and bring such great perspectives. So AI models in general deliver a confidence interval, but in practice, we see that it solidifies into a single sort of yes or no response. What do you see coming in terms of AI research that would allow us to build artificial intelligences that are capable of code switching?
Code switching.
And code switching is hard for people. I mean, I don't know anything about that particular topic for AI. I think one of the things that is interesting is the ability of AI to sort of take context into account and, as you say, to produce probabilistic results. And even though oftentimes with, say, a classifier because of the system in which it's used, we force it into some sort of binary choice, frequently, deep inside of the machine, there are much more complex representations. And in fact, this turns out to be something that's extremely valuable. It's something that has been called unreasonably effective. That, for example, if you take an image classifier, something that's just designed to say, okay, that's a dog, that's a cat, but then look at the internals, you can use those internals to do all sorts of other really interesting things that are often very subtle, like to say, how similar is this dog to this other dog? Or even you can sort of start to interpret a little bit why it might have made a decision one way or the other. So again, this is far afield from your question about code switching, but I think your point about the fact that we don't have to deal in sort of discrete yes-no questions, I think is something that is incredibly important to explore with AI, and it's a very rich area to explore as well.
Mm-hmm. Was there? Mm-hmm. Oh, there's somebody there at the bottom, and then we'll take Jay, and then okay.
Hi. This relates somewhat to the last two questions and answers, but I want to try to sharpen it a bit. I was very interested in the art video where it was said that, you know, we can produce effective art objects which will get people's interests. But what happens then, as was pointed out, is that people begin to talk about their experiences, and we learn from what other people have to say. We may change it, we may come up with something new which hasn't been thought about before. Similarly, when we come to judges, you can build two systems, one that looks at things one way, the other looks at it very different. But where we learn is when judges talk to one another and they come up with something which neither of them would have come up with on their own. And I guess my question is, do we have any examples so far of artificial intelligence systems or robots where there's actually some going beyond where either of them was before, where we kind of stuck with what they've been programmed with, and you really would have to bring some human in or a third entity in to extend the conversation in new ways.
Thank you. Did you?
So one of the things that we're very interested in,
So I don't have a crisp answer to your question, but one of the things I think that touches on what you said is this notion of what different kinds of partnerships could you have with an intelligent system, right? We're used to using computer systems that have, a lot of times if they are not AI-enabled, have very prescriptive and kind of, we know all the scenarios, and I do this, and the system does that. With AI, it's less deterministic, right? So there is a chance, maybe, that we will get somewhere where I haven't been before. And so one of the questions that we're very interested in is how, because a lot of times these systems have these kind of huge overviews of huge spaces of possibilities, how can I work with the system in interesting and unexpected way? So imagine, for instance, that I am a designer or an architect, and I have a set of requirements that I'm going to go for. I need to build, I need to project a house, design a house. But the system is then working with me kind of in a dance or in a dialogue where it says, well, I have this huge palette of possibilities here. And then I can tell it, oh yeah, I kind of like these other ones, forget it. Let's go this way. Now what else can we do here? And so can these systems start to take us in very different unexpected directions that maybe I myself would not have thought of, but just as a way to show me diversity, to show me different possibilities? And then can it learn from me? That's one of the things that we're learning, for instance, in working with doctors, which is different doctors have different ways of traversing very different diagnostic spaces. And some of them like to see a lot of diversity, others like to hone in, or some of them do one and then the other. So how can the system then learn and take those specific styles into account, or specific tasks? And again, I think that's how we start to design these systems with a user in mind, with a need in mind, with a workflow in mind that respects and works with its audience. And I think those are very interesting and potentially very creative spaces that we're just starting to explore now.
Thank you. Jay.
Hi, this has just been really wonderful. I want to thank you for your presentations, and thank you for including at least one disabled person, because when you talk about marginalized communities, please don't forget the disabled. So I have two little thoughts I would like to have you expand on, which you've sort of touched on, and that's the issue of control and humanness. So you've talked about governments, you've talked about laws, you've talked about companies, but do you really think we're going to be able to control this? We also, it sounds like we're talking about one intelligence, so there could be multiples. And my, you know, worry is it's going to be a kid writing an instructable, here's how to make an awesome AI. But, and then the other part is humanness. Is it really beneficial to make AI be more human? Yeah. Because humans have been causing problems for forever. And if you're going to teach a robot how to be compassionate, then they're going to also learn the opposite. And that's how you end up with the Terminator dystopia. So what are your thoughts on that?
Small questions, you said. Yeah, okay. So who wants to take the control, and is it worth making them human?
Oh, okay. So people are looking at me, so
yeah,
I will
absolutely
see if I can say something to that. I don't know about control. So I have to say that I come to this really as artist citizen, right? So I don't know, although I refuse in general the dystopian hypotheses, only because I feel like these things are coming towards us and there are things that we need to be thinking about, and how, like, the questions you're asking, like, what is it going to mean and how do we take it forward? I also find myself here thinking about the idea of control and who's asking all these the question that you're asking, like, who's asking these questions and who's getting to define the things that even get thought about. And then I also think about this idea of the questions that we as, I'm going to say in an American context, the questions that we don't want to talk about and that we kind of always push to the side as opposed to address them. And thinking about what and how we might employ or not AI to start thinking about those things, or at least making a kind of space for those conversations, whether they include the AI or not, is what becomes important to me. And I feel like I'm not addressing your question in a way.
No, no, you are.
But I feel like these are sort of important issues or places of thinking about, well, what is that control? Who are the questions coming from? If we can't ask every question, what questions can we put forward? And how do we put them forward? And who, like, who gets to put them forward? Is it a 2-year-old? A 5-year-old? 110-year-old? I don't know. Yeah.
Anybody wants to add?
I think one thing that is hard about this is we don't know what all the implications are. That it's like any new technology where I think if we sat down and wrote everything on paper that we thought would happen, we would discover 100 years from now that like a lot of what we worried about wasn't important and we'd missed a lot of things. There was a time when people thought that the invention of telephones would make everyone deaf. That's probably not the thing that you should worry about most with phones, it turns out. And so I think we have to commit to trying to like make progress and be very careful, like very, very observational, like what is actually happening when we put things out in the world. Ah, we need to course correct now. We've learned something. We're doing experiments. I don't think we're just going to be able to leap to the end point right away of a utopia. I also don't think we'll end up with the Terminator as long as we sort of are careful to observe, experiment, and be willing to think in terms of progress.
What I like very much about this panel is how pragmatic we tend to be in front of this new landscape that needs to be designed. You know, I've grown tired of fictions, you know, and instead I so much like this stance that is at the same time hopeful but also action based. You know, so I think that what I've learned tonight, besides the fact that it's very important that we need to think of the future we want and move in that direction. There are a few points that I found were really, really revealing for me. One is the accountability point. I've almost started thinking that we need a fourth power that deals only with AI, you know, and also the open-endedness, the potential of open-endedness. I really love it when you talked about, Kate, about Facebook going from 2 genders to 56 descriptions to the desire of having the open field. And I merged that with what Martin said we can learn from AI. So maybe we can learn to be more comfortable with fluidity, more comfortable with other sets of beliefs. I don't know, it could really help us. But first and foremost, we need to all be more knowledgeable and understanding of AI so that as citizens, we can have those tools, and that's where art comes into play. I was trying to kind of sum up the night for all of you, but that's what I have learned. And I have to say, it was a fantastic panel. It was a fantastic audience. Erica, you were fantastic. Wherever you are, you're there. You know, she's always like standing in the background, but she should really be forefront because she did all the research. But this was a wonderful night that is going to continue outside with our usual so-so wine. Really great conversation. Great conversation. And thank you all very, very much. Thank you also on the live stream audience. And the next salon, which we'll send you about, will be about the importance of words. It'll come soon. We'll send you the invitation. But thank you, you wonderful people.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's great.